Raise your hand if you want a better financial year this year. We do too. We'll talk about it next on Smart Money. Hi, I'm Pat Boyle, along with co-host Julia Anderson on Smart Money. Why do we have our hands raised? Well, it's because we would like to see a better year financially for all of us. So that's why our hands are up. And we're lucky to have our business expert, Julia Anderson, to walk us through it. Julia is going to tell us some things we can do to make ourselves more financially strong in 2022. Now, Julia, one thing you say is to make sure your retirement savings is going full blast, right?
Yeah, I guess the five things I'm suggesting we need to keep at it in terms of saving. The good news is that a lot of Americans actually saved money during this last year of 2021. You know, there was some bailout money for the COVID thing, and a lot of families actually chucked more money into savings. So that's a really good start. So at the beginning of 2022, number one suggestion is make sure you're still keeping up with your long-term retirement savings plan. If you've got a job that has a 401k, be sure that you're putting enough money in there out of your paycheck so that you are getting the company matching. That's the money the company will put into that program for you. It's free money, so make sure you're doing that. If you don't have a 401k, start an individual retirement account. That's also tax deferred. So any earnings inside that account are not taxed, and you can reinvest it and grow your savings for retirement. So that's a big number one.
And I remember as a young worker, 23 or whatever, and I was lucky enough to have a 401k, and it was like, oh, whatever, retirement's so far away, but do it right away because it will add up. Don't just say, who needs it right now? You may not need it now, but you need it later. And I wanted to tell you a couple of figures that I ran across. I saw a figure that said there are about 600,000 401k plans in the country. 60 million people have accounts. And then Bankrate.com did a survey last fall that shows, and this was of concern to me, that shows 51% took an early withdrawal, 20% did that during the pandemic. So I wonder how much catch-up there's going to be post-pandemic, you know?
Well, that's another aside to the whole long-term savings plan. Don't borrow from your long-term savings. And it's for two reasons. One is you are taking money out instead of putting money in. But the big deal is that over time, that money is going to generate more income for you going forward as the miracle of compound interest and compound earnings add to your funds. So people have asked me this before, and you know, can I take money out of my 401k? And I'm pretty adamant about saying, no, don't do that. And borrow from your parents or whatever to avoid that. So that's my number one. Number two would be to do a household budget and figure out where you are. And I think this is especially important because of inflation. You may be paying more for transportation every month because of higher gas prices. You are certainly paying more at the grocery store for your family household food bill. And as you start the new year, you know, come up with a rough estimate on what those higher costs are going to be and how maybe you can manage other aspects of your spending in the household so that you don't have to break the bank or use credit cards to buy stuff. So, Pat, are you doing a household budget this year, starting out the year?
We didn't sit down and do a budget, but we actually have talked about cars, which have been such an issue. We both have cars that are fully paid for. My husband wants to get rid of his. Can he get good money for it? Yeah. Can he get into a new one or a late used one for good money? No. The numbers are staggering. Edmunds.com says half of Americans right now have less income than is considered necessary to buy the average used car. And the average used car is $29,000. I mean, this is the crazy world we're living in. And so one of your suggestions is take a bus. And I think that's great if you're in an urban area. But the whole used car thing, it's upside down right now. So as we drive, especially me, I tend to drive more. It's like, please don't anybody run into me. I don't want to get another used car or a new car. This thing's paid for. I want it to run forever. And so I'm being an extra defensive driver. That's what I'm doing budget-wise, I guess, so far this year.
Well, you know, you speak to a really important deal. So my older son had his car totaled in a one of those intersection accidents where somebody T-boned him. And
sorry.
He'd had it for 10 years. It was running good. It was looking a little bit, you know, whatever. But anyway, it ended up getting totaled by the insurance company. So he's carless. And he's trying to put a good spin on it in that he lives in the downtown urban Seattle area. So he's thinking he can get along without a car, which means lower insurance costs, no car, lower transportation costs in general. And he's using something called gig.com, which you can rent a car for a few hours, depending on if you need one or not, and they park them around in the area and you can find one to drive. I wish I had that website in front of me. I don't, but there's probably several things like that you can do if you want to go carless as one way to reduce your household income or household expenses. So another number three on my list of what to do to manage your money is to get a better job. This is the easiest thing you can do to raise your income. And right now it looks to me like employers are desperate for reliable, conscientious workers, and they're paying more to hire them and keep them and retain them. So if you're in a job that you like, you'd like more money, I would talk to your employer and say, what are the chances of getting a 10% raise? I would be assertive about it, either find a new job or ask for a raise in the job you've got, because employers really are valuing the people they've got on the workforce.
And how often has it been that way, that it's a workers' market? I mean, usually it's like you have all the competition and now you can pretty much call your shots. I was reading an article recently about applying for a job, and it said, first of all, it said get there 15 minutes early so you can kind of, you know, get calm before you go in, and then walk through the door 5 minutes early so you're there and on time. And I hadn't run into this before, Julia, maybe you have, but it said, as you interview, you be the one to bring up money first. Like, well, tell me what this job pays or what you're offering. And I guess I had always thought, well, you wait for them to tell you what they're willing to pay. And so that, to me, that was kind of turning the tables a little bit. And I wondered if it was because of the era and the times we're in.
I think you're right. And as 2021 went on and more people dropped out of the workforce, I mean, it's been a crazy time because a lot of women especially have had to leave jobs to take care of the kids because they're homeschooled or they're sick or whatever. And so it's been a crazy year, and it's been hard to get people to come back to work because of those same factors. Right now we're in the Omicron thing, and I'm wondering if some of the schools are gonna start asking for long distance learning again. And that has an impact on families and who's gonna be with the kids. So there is a good reason to feel like you can be confident about talking to an employer about pay. Either someone that you're already working for, or if you find a new job. And I mean, all kinds of people, all kinds of employers are hiring right now. I saw a big ad for railroads. They're looking for employees, and they're even giving out bonuses to sign up with them. So, and I don't think you have to have some kind of previous background in the job that you might be interested in. And I think a lot of employers feel that way too, in that they'll train you to do the technical part of the job. What they want is somebody who's, you know, intelligent, who's going to show up, who's going to be there and be reliable for them. So they can train the technical aspects of whatever job you might say, you know, with the railroad, for instance, just to get you in the door. So it's a great job market right now.
So you wonder if that also covers older workers who sometimes may find a harder time finding a job, that now that expertise and that stick-to-itiveness is appreciated if you're retraining for something else. Maybe it's a better market for older workers too.
Right. And you know, one of the things I've long preached is to delay taking Social Security, because every year that you delay, you can give yourself a big raise in terms of the benefits all the way to age 70. So if you're over 60 and you're trying to figure out what to do in terms of retirement, I'm guessing you could probably find a part-time job that would keep you going for a couple of years so that you did not have to claim Social Security. So yeah, I agree with you. I think older workers, especially those you know, I mean, we're all reliable, right? We all showed up for our jobs for a long time.
We're here today, aren't we?
Yeah, right. For like 30 years of getting up at 6 o'clock. So anyway, yeah. So I said that it's a very strong job market for people who want a job.
What about investments?
Well, investments is another aspect of maybe what I mentioned before, the long-term retirement plan. Inside or outside of a retirement plan, you need to be investing for the long term. You hear a lot of gurus talking about having an emergency fund. And there's a lot of ways to enhance your long-term investments by being inside of a individual retirement account, a Roth individual retirement account, which means you've paid the taxes already. So when you take the money out of a Roth IRA, it's tax-free. So there's a lot of strategies for how to build your long-term savings. And with the job market being strong and employers paying more, I think it's essential that people, again, concentrate on the long-term. We're going to eventually get through this pandemic. It'll either be because of vaccines or boosters, or the whole thing will just fade away at some point. I'm really confident of that. And so you need to keep your eye on the long-term savings ball and investing ball. And honestly, I think the stock market is where you need to be simply because it has this great track record. The U.S. stock market has returned an average of 10% a year, every year for the last 50 years. We've had some pretty good years lately, so we might have a cool off in 2022, but you've got to be in the stock market to help get to where you want to go with retirement.
Is there a particular sector that you think is more hot right now than others in the stock market?
Well, for sure, there are sectors that are hot and cold. Right now, there's a big sell-off in tech, and the reason is simple. If interest rates go up, as the Federal Reserve says it's going to do, then some of these high-flying hot stocks are going to cool off big time because a secure certificate of deposit is going to look more attractive to investors than a high-flying tech stock. So there's going to be some churn in the market. And as our previous guest today, Bill Connerly, said, you know, there's going to be more ups and downs. But I think you just need to kind of step back and not worry about timing the market and not worrying about sectors versus hot ones versus cold ones, and just stay the course.
Stay the course. That's good advice. You also have more good advice, Julia, on a will and a designated health person. COVID, if it's taught us anything, it's that you could be gone tomorrow and you might not have your
absolutely
will.
Yeah, and this is not a money thing per se. But if you somehow got COVID, ended up in the hospital and died, your heirs would thank you to their last breath for having a will and designated healthcare directives in place. I think COVID has taught us all of that. I mean, we've had a lot of people die in Oregon and in Washington with COVID. And I don't know what the numbers are, but I'm wondering how many of them had a will. A simple will that would help sort out their assets at death. It's a legal requirement. You've got to settle their estate. And the best way and easiest way to do that is to give your heirs a will and have designated healthcare directives for what to do for you if you're hospitalized and can't make decisions for yourself. So that's my number five on my short list of things to do to start the new year.
So let's run them down again just quickly. Number one.
Oh, no, you're going to have me do it? Okay, number one.
There are your tips. I'll just say the number. You're going to say the tip.
That's fine. I can do it. Save for the long term. Invest inside of 401ks. Take the time to do a household budget so you know where your money's going, and maybe you can tweak some things so that you don't overspend. Have a will and healthcare directives in place. And consider getting a new or better job or asking your employer for a big raise. This is the time that employees are in the driver's seat, and it's a great time for people to generate more income by doing some of those things. So those are my top tips.
Those are great tips. She is Julia Anderson, co-host of Department and our co-host Pat Boyle. We will see you next time.
For more information, go to my website at 60andsingle.com.